Hello, my name is Dana Brown. I am owner of Time's Dark Captains, and I'm also a training manager at Jebco Associates. In this particular video, we're going to address moisture and mold sensitive materials and the problems we have in buildings and dealing with this issue that's becoming a bigger and bigger problem in new building practices and new construction practices. So stay here and we'll get to it. With respect to mold assessment and remediation, we're fighting basically yesterday's wars with today's materials. And that can be a problem. The materials used in recent past, true dimension old growth lumber and timber, plaster walls, hardwood floors, old growth lumber and timber, tile floors, hardwood cabinets, metal cabinets, concrete, masonry stone, terrazzo flooring, all these materials used to be less of a problem because they were not moisture sensitive. They did not bring in a lot of moisture. And secondarily, it was very difficult to attack these materials with regular molds. Most of our regular molds that we deal with in indoor molds, they tend to like a high cellulose content. And in these high cellulose content materials, they tend to have more of our molds that we have problems with called water damage indicator molds, Stachybotrys, Chaetomium, Eulocladium, and Fusarium and the like. These materials are commonly used in building construction prior to the 1970s. Additionally, prior to the 1970s, buildings were not air sealed as much as they are now and do not have as much insulation in the walls or ceilings. This is one of our problems when we start drying out buildings. One of the issues about drying out buildings is you have to take the insulation out. You have to get the thermal mass to move around in order to move around the water. After the 1970s and into the 1980s, a revolution occurred in the construction industry due to energy crisis of the 1970s and financial fallout later in the 1980s with the Black Monday type situations. A large movement came into the construction industry where virtually all buildings were insulated, air sealed, and contemporary times now air sealing is part of the structure, is now code in certain areas as well. With the revolution in the energy savings efforts, it was coupled with the advancement of the science and application of what we call engineered materials. So now engineered materials, we're now taking plasters and changing them into resins, adding adhesives and polymers. Today's stucco is not yesterday's stucco. Yesterday's stucco is just basically lime and sand and those kind of material base. Today they may have polymers in it to where they act now like a vapor barrier. So when these resins, adhesives, and polymers, they're added to a mix of stone, wood, steel, aluminum, glass, and they add advantages in production, economic profit, ease of installation, and lead to an explosion of engineered materials and their deployment and installation in buildings in the construction industry all total. Some of the materials are now just so common it's hard to believe they were there just a decade ago. Like materials like OSB, oriented strand board, generally wasn't on the job site much. Now it's ubiquitous everywhere. It's generally what we use. Particle boards, hardboards made out of pulverized wood material. Older versions such as masonite was used for siding, and you don't see masonite very much anymore. Drywall is now ubiquitous too in every building, and even with the problems they try to alter the paper face drywall with waxes and greens or purple, green or purple colorings, they basically try to insist that the materials are mold proof or moisture resistant, and the problem is they're just basically making the water move slower in an organic material. Laminate flooring also became very popular for a time because it was cheap, it was easy to install. But lost that popularity when it became very apparent that the material was highly susceptible to moisture absorption, which ruined the flooring. And couple this with the fact that you also put a vapor barrier underneath the wood, so when it gets wet on top, there's no way for it to go one way or the other. Anything below the slab can't come up through that moisture barrier also. So you really have a real problem in putting a vapor barrier where you really don't need one. Wood and structural lumber is not like it was anything a few decades ago. Now we have genetically modified woods and such, and they grow very fast. So fast, in fact, structural capacity of wood does not meet the same temperature, the same requirements of slower growing woods as well. As an example here of some of our genetically modified woods, here we have one, as you can see, it has only 7 or 8 grains across this, no matter how you look. And if you look across the edge, it even becomes more apparent. These used to have 30 or 40 grains on the end of that. And the problem with that is, as you have less tree rings, as it grows faster, the tree rings are farther apart, they have less structural capacity. And therefore, things like 2x10s and 2x6s don't have the support that the structural capacity they had once had before. So a 2x10 that maybe could do a 22-foot span can now only do 16 feet. Now, the other thing we do, the closer the tree rings, as I said, the more likely the wood is less more strong. And you can ask this any boat builder. Grain tells you everything you need to know about the wood and its strength. So timber and lumber are now replaced with porous and more water-sensitive materials like I-joist, OSB structural assemblies, and they have more moisture sensitivity. This is a group of fast-growing engineered wood products that are coming out. Now, older buildings with older building materials, they're simply wipe off. I mean, if you had old true dimension lumber that had 30 tree rings, it's probably whatever mold on, you basically wipe it off. In today's building materials that are more porous, these materials tend to be more water sensitive, so they're bringing in more water, and also the mold can now penetrate easier in there. So wiping off is generally not going to be an appropriate or an applicable activity to do remediation for mold on these materials. They'll likely have to be removed and replaced, which is again a different cost. This is one of the reasons why we're using these materials. It's cheaper to put them in the first place. And then when we get to the remediation phase, one of the big problems is that they say, oh gee, it costs too much, can you save it? Well, you put it in the first place because it was cheap. That's why you put it in there. Now, paper-faced drywall, it's a great product for interior walls, hallways, any kind of partitions or rooms or stuff like that. But however, the application on exterior walls, especially in hot environments where you're doing cooling on the inside, anything where you have a lot of heat differential, any kind of rooms that are going to have abnormal either moisture content or abnormal temperature extremes. However, paper-faced drywall should never have been put into kitchens, bathrooms, showers, laundry rooms, or any rooms where those materials could, or that space could come into contact with either higher moisture content or directly with water contact. I call these walls water walls, and water walls would be where you have a chase in the shower, a chase in the bathroom. And again, the entire bathroom is the problem, because not only can they get exposed to water around the showers and the toilet and sinks and whatnot, but also when you take showers or you're cooking in the kitchen or whatever, you're liberating water from its liquid form into a gaseous form, and that stuff can go all over. And you've seen this where it condensates out on the wall. So these water walls, again, not just the walls that have tubes and pipes in them, but also where we have assemblies that will come in contact with condensating surfaces as well. The building owner or the builder should both opt for cement board or fiberglass-based drywall products or some kind of other surfacing materials in here to make sure that we're not getting water into those materials or into the substructure as well. Furnishings and contents are now made of materials or chipboard, hardboard, medium density fiber boards, and once these are wet, they're usually not salvageable. Joe Steberg goes off on how particle board is made, and it's basically made with urea, which is an equivalent of urine. And that's why when these materials get wet, they do smell like urine, because again, what's in them? Urine. That's the nitrogen in there as a fixation agent to have all these chips stay together. Now, I have an example here. If you look at this, this is pretty much most of our put together camlock furnishings. A lot of our cabinets are now made of this stuff as well. This is a chipboard or again a particle board of some kind, and it's usually covered with a vinyl. And what happens when that gets wet? Well, when that gets wet, it swells up. And not only when it swells up, it also extends its surface area, so mold can now get in these pores, and now it can now move or grow the filaments in between those particles as well as it grows and swells with water and as the mold colonies grow. Since these materials will continue to be used, different installation requirements are required for these materials. As I said, we're fighting yesterday's war, meaning the contractors are still installing these materials as they're doing hardwood cabinets. You can go back into a 1950s bungalow and look at, and if you ever take one of those apart, especially a kitchen area, you take apart those cabinets, they come out monolithically, or they come out in pieces, and that's because they're hardwood. And if you take that hardwood or dimensional lumber out and you look on the back of it, they've actually painted the back. Now, nobody sees the back. Why'd they paint it? Well, again, they're waterproofing. They are doing something we call fail-safing it. It's going to fail in a safe manner. All you got to do is dry it out. Today's particular construction doesn't have anything to do with long-term preservation of these attachments, and especially cabinets, because what do you do? Well, if one gets wet and it gets all bad, we take it out and we just go get another one at Home Depot or one of the stores there for $150. Probably comes with a sink. So again, this use, and I don't consider this to be sustainable. This is what we need to look at in new buildings. New buildings don't last as long as older buildings most of the time, that are made out of more substantial, less water sensitive materials. Buildings are now made out of less substantial materials, buildings aren't going to last as long, and in order for them to make them last long, we're going to have to be changing out those surfaces, because as they load with water or they get impacted, we're going to have to take them out. And if they do get wet, we have to take them out and the insulation in there as well. So it's problematic. So since the materials will continue to be used, these different installations, we need to make sure we're installing them properly. For example, OSB is ubiquitous. It's a sheeting material, and we put Tyvek over it. Well, that's a water vapor barrier over a water sensitive material, which is a good thing. But if water gets behind that particular vapor barrier, that membrane, that OSB is going to stay wet forever. And that's a problem, especially if you have foil faced foam, and then you put OSB on the outside of that, and then you put Tyvek on the outside of that. In that situation, especially around window openings, you're going to have pan flashing. If you have OSB and Tyvek, or OSB and a vapor barrier, you have to pan flash those windows. And again, this is one of the vapor barrier combos like Huber Zip and these other products that are coming out. Again, they're looking at protecting of those edges of that OSB. That's really where the problem is on flashing. Matt Reisinger has a lot on the Build channel dealing with particular issue, and flashing the edge of Huber Zip as well, again, to make sure that edge of the Huber Zip is protected. If it's not protected, again, it's going to act like just like any OSB there. So if not, OSB directly under the window will become saturated and not only grow mold, but it will become structurally unsound. You're going to have to tear the sheeting off and replace it, which is even more expensive as well. So sheeting should stay dry, and that's the key thing about sheeting. Building industry is going to continue using these products. New ones will be created and deployed into the construction industry before we know fate of these particular materials. The key to using the materials is to not put them in wet areas, keep them dry, respond immediately to every elevated moisture event or water intrusion event. Proper functioning of the HVAC system is now imperative in buildings that are full of moisture-sensitive materials and mold-sensitive materials. It's not just thermal comfort we're worried about now. We have to keep the grains per pound between 35 and 65 grains per pound there. That way we know we're not accumulating water in these moisture-sensitive materials. Incidentally, these buildings, how we're building them contemporarily, they cannot be wet one more minute. They have to be Johnny on the spot dried out. So this is why we're seeing a massive increase. We do mold training, and a lot of these are restoration businesses. And they are just, we got people who come in as a worker for a while for their 4-hour mold worker class in Texas. And then in 2 years, they're taking their contractor class and opening their own franchise in a restoration business. That's because every new building in the zip code cannot be wet one more minute, a moment longer, because it will grow mold. And this is commercial and modern residential. So if you want to know a franchise to go into a water restoration and a drying business. Again, there's work out there every time these buildings get flooded. And they're not like the 1970s buildings that are all masonry, that you can basically squeegee out the water, hose it off, squeegee it out, put some fans around. This, you're actually having to deassemble the building assemblies, his walls and whatnot, to get air, heat, and water to move where he want, and to dehumidify and dewater the assemblies and the materials in that building. Now, with these particular addition of buildings, HVAC systems on mold and moisture, it's not only heating and cooling and comfort now, it's also management throughout the building with ventilation as well. But also, we need to make sure we're getting any kind of moisture that we're generating is also getting outside the building envelope from the rooms or the areas where it's generated. Kitchens, break areas, bathrooms, laundry rooms, they all need to have good ventilation systems and good positive ventilation to where you actually are bringing in dry air and you're taking out the warmer, more humid air. And then the other part you need to worry about is where you have high occupancy periods. And high occupancy with a lot of human beings can put a lot of moisture in the air as well. If the space has a faucet, drain, stove, HVAC, or water appliance, then the area must be what I call water hardened. So if you have water hardening, that means I want materials that absorb moisture slowly. And if you do this, like I say, if you had modern construction, they put drywall in to go like, well, it's cheaper on the build. Well, it's cheaper until you have a water event. In a water event, most of the time, insurance and contractors just want to remove that. You're getting charged to replace that. It is a sacrificial material now. It's not there forever. And that's a unique thing, a unique concept we need to get into as managing buildings. We have sacrificial surfaces, so we take them out. Again, a great example of a sacrificial surface is a laminate floor. Instead of cleaning the thing or trying to resurface it, we just pull it up, throw it away, put new stuff in. And this is really where I'm going to from the environmental area. This is an unsustainable practice to have sacrificial surfaces in modern buildings, whether they be residences or whatever. So a non-sacrificial surface would be something like putting in cement board or fiberglass reinforced panels, fiberglass coated drywall or face drywall products in these areas, and then putting your tiles and whatever over this. So you have materials that are going to reject moisture, and if they do get moist, all you got to do is dry them out, and they don't have any material in there that's going to grow mold significantly. And that's really what we're looking for as well. So again, if it has water intrusion, if it has water intentionally added to it, or it has a high differential of heat transfer, you need to put different surfaces. Now, if you just have a basic building material that has a building area that's just like a cubicle farm and it just has some partitions that don't have any water in there, drywall is a fine product for that, especially if you're moving around hallways and whatnot as well. So again, we got to think in terms of application of these building materials a little bit differently. In kitchens, ventilation is done with a range hood, and you should not use ventless appliances here. Again, all they're doing with ventless appliances is they're blowing that moisture in there. Now, this is especially true if you have gas appliances, such as a gas stove or a gas oven. These particular appliances, when they burn natural gas or propane, one of the combustion products is water vapor. And these especially need to be ventilated because they can put a lot of water vapor in the air rapidly. So we want to get it also outside the building envelope. We want to make sure these are vented outside the envelope, not just in houses. We just go up the ceiling in the kitchen and blow it in the attic. That's the worst place you could possibly do it, either in the north or the south United States. HVAC systems are currently installed for thermal comfort, and as quickly as possible, if the red light comes or the light comes on and it's blowing cold air or hot air, it's installed. And that's really not what it needs to be done. It needs to be properly sized and installed so you get better energy efficiency. This is another thing about energy efficiency a lot of people don't know. 17% of our total nation's energy spend is in HVAC systems. So that's where our greatest level of reduction of carbon-based fuels and electricity, that's where you can save a lot of money right there. It is, again, the heating and ventilation of the building is really where we eat a lot of money. It takes a lot of money to run a fan and also to heat air and to add energy to air to heat it or to remove energy from the air to cool it. Now, properly sized, it works. However, fast slap-it-in installations, which is, again, in most of our track housing, these guys have an incentive to get these things done as quickly as possible. So they basically slap in the same unit, and they slap in the same kind of ductwork and everywhere, and this can cause a lot of problems. Not only do we have excessively high heating and cooling bills, but also raising moisture levels. One of the craziest things is putting air handlers in attics in the south. That's absolutely insane. It is not a good thing. It is not cheaper. You may say save 25 to 30 square feet inside the house structure by not having by having that open and not having an HVAC closet. However, since that thing's up in the air, what usually happens is they put a much larger unit and it's not dehumidifying as much, or it is the right size. And it's basically struggling to keep that heat load down in the house because you're cooling things down to 55 degrees or close to dew point in that HVAC box, and then you blow it in ductwork that's in the attic that's very hot, and it may come out 60, 65 degrees. So you're paying to get 55 degree air, and you're getting it, but then you're putting it in a thermally efficient process to where it's reheating the air. So it is, again, we need to look at our houses and sustainability, and have sustainability as a physics scientific standard instead of it's a green thing to do. Everybody can say sustainability. In fact, LEED buildings are horrible in some of the aspects, and they're claimed to be very sustainable, yet we're having to tear out all these sacrificial surfaces, and they're not that energy efficient. So again, LEED is a great idea, but again, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. I'm not a fan of it, as you can tell. The expedience in building residence has led to an uncomfortable practice, as I said, of putting these HVAC systems in the attics and unconditioned spaces to save costs on space rather than saving the HVAC and conservation of energy through proper application of the laws of thermodynamics. That really is the key thing. Again, some contractor putting in a HVAC system, and the guy has expertise running concrete and putting in drywall and framing. Well, again, we have to deal with thermodynamics, and that person may not know properly what thermodynamics are required as well. As I said, too many HVAC systems are simply installed. They're not sized and engineered for that space with proper load calculations, and don't serve that building space very well. And this is a real crime in our by now we should have energy efficient buildings. We really need to start looking at how we're building spaces, especially residences. Residents probably account for a lot of that 17% of energy spend in our country because they are such inefficient track built houses. And again, most building, we don't get to build custom houses anymore. We don't get to buy custom houses unless we go buy an old one. Most of the custom houses is the way houses used to be built. Now they're spec houses, and the only thing you get to really make your mind up on is, are you going to have tile, what color of tile, and are you going to have black stainless steel or basic stainless steel appliances, or are you going to have granite countertops? And then all the houses are the same. So again, we've kind of lost our imagination, really, with this turn and burn economy in construction as well. In a majority of commercial buildings, the heating and cooling needs are supplied with rooftop mounted units, or what we call RTUs, and the majority of these are draw-through systems, and this is something we really need to pay attention to. In the draw-through system, the unit and the evaporator coil are under negative pressure. So that means if you don't have a proper P-trap, or the P-trap is broken, or it's a PVC P-trap outside, it's been hit by hail, or it's being degraded or cracked for some reason, and it can allow air ingestion, you now no longer hold negative pressure. Now without that P-trap, or with a damaged P-trap, you start ingesting air in the system, and that now causes what we call water droplet carryover or drain pan overflow. Both of these conditions can put a significant amount of moisture in the building. And again, we paid to get rid of it all. We've basically extracted all that water, it's in the drain pan, and now because of water droplet carryover or drain pan overflow, we're basically blowing it in the supply line, And again, we're just basically burning money. And it is a very uncomfortable situation because it raises the humidity in the building. It can also cause widespread vapor pressure dominated mold growth, but it also can cause that dirty sock odor or that nasty smelling musty odor in a building as well. Now, these draw-through systems are not uncommon, are uncommon in residential application, but they're starting to be more installed more. Now, they're very common in say, Southern Florida or Southern California, and in those areas where you generally don't have too many days you need heating. And therefore, they basically have just a basic space heater and then an air conditioner. And the draw-through system is more efficient in creating cold air. Now, if mold is in a structure, the moisture should never be removed by the HVAC system. And this is now in the ICRC S520. In their third edition, they have clearly stated and adopted the policy the HVAC system should not be used to dehumidify air during mold remediation. And your contractors should know it, and now you, the building owner and consumer, know that as well. I'm going to be putting out a video on the ICRC, what it is, in conjunction with the Texas mold rules coming up in another video. In short, with contemporary building sensibilities, selection and installation of building materials, your cost considerations of building materials, moisture sensitive and mold sensitive materials now have to be scrutinized, and they're going to be used at a higher rate because they are going to be cheap, quick to install, and efficient to make, so they're on the shelves as well. So keeping these materials dry and the moisture levels controlled in a building requires a different prioritization of energy use, HVAC installation, and also monitoring or surveillance of the building. Considering this, the HVAC systems must be designed, installed, and maintained properly. Qualified and capable HVAC contractors and engineers should be involved in consulting in addressing HVAC systems or in commercial buildings changes in the operation or the spacings or the use of the building. That's a very big thing. Sometimes we go into these multi-story buildings and they're just basically cubicle farms with a few partitions in them. And again, that changes the whole way air flows. And once you change airflow or heat flow, you change moisture flow as well. If you do these things, this will ensure the building material will be kept dry as possible and the required thermal comfort levels ensured, and you get all of your uses out of these moisture sensitive materials as well. So that's the end of this particular video. I'm going to have other videos dealing with mold and moisture events and how we're looking at building materials. As I said earlier in this video, I'm going to be looking at one with the IICRC S520 and a comparison of how it interacts with the mold. We have a lot of contractors and water restoration people running around saying, like, I follow IICRS 520, and they have no clue what's in it. And so I will be dealing with that in a future video, since I brought it up here in the HVAC requirement and the IICRC requirement of, if you have mold remediation, you turn on the HVAC system and use it for moisture control. So that's it for this particular video. Look forward to seeing you and others. If you like this video, go ahead and subscribe. And again, hit that notification, because I've got a lot more videos coming out dealing with some of my favorite topics. And one of my favorite topics coming out is going to be dealing with manufacturing and reinvigorating and reanimating our small town economies, and why that's a great, great thing for this country as well. So look to see you later, and hope you fare well.